In 1970, a man by the name of Bill Daniels, our college's namesake, purchased the Utah Stars, an American Basketball Association team. He held the Utah Stars from 1970 to 1975. During that time, the Stars struggled. Their finances were hard. At the same time, Bill had many ventures that were failing. As hard as he tried, in 1975, Bill Daniels had to declare bankruptcy. He was so disappointed. He had let his ticket holders down. They didn't have the entertainment that he had promised. And as importantly, he had let his creditors down. He promised to make good on his promises. It took him 8 years. But he went back to Salt Lake City after 8 years, and he repaid every single one of his creditors, even though he didn't have to, according to the law, and he sought out every single ticket holder to repay them plus 8% interest. Bill Daniels embodied the heroic spirit of business, and that's something that we try to teach day in and day out here in the Daniels College of Business because, frankly, we don't think about it often enough around the world. Tonight's speaker, John Mackey, the co-CEO of Whole Foods, is also a person that focuses on the higher purpose of business and hopes that he can help spread the message about creating a heroic spirit in business. Before we get started tonight, though, I also want to recognize the people that make this program possible. Our financial sponsors are U.S. Bank, Grant Thornton, First Bank, CoBank, Chase, Financial Executives International, and Daniels College Working Professionals Programs. Our in-kind sponsors are the National Association of Corporate Directors, the Denver Metro Chamber of Commerce, Net Impact, and Marketing Roundtable. Let's give all of our sponsors a very warm thank you. So our speaker tonight's an exciting man. Just like Bill Daniels, he's passionate, he's outspoken, and he has a focus on business. He's recently authored a book with Raj Sasasoda called Conscious Capitalism. Tonight we're gonna do an interview format where I'll be asking John some questions about his book and also his journey at Whole Foods, and then we'll open up for audience participation. Now I know the University of Denver and I know the Daniels College of Business, so let's bring down the house and welcome John Mackey. Congratulations. I told John while it's snowing outside, it's definitely a little bit warmer in here. So John, I had a chance to meet your college roommate on Thursday last week, Kip Tindall, who's the CEO of the Container Store. And he said that you were the most interesting kid on campus. Well, what I want to do is that you must have had an amazing series of conversations in the dorm room to have CEO of the Container Store and the CEO of Whole Foods being college roommates. Who knows what's starting here at the University of Denver. Could you just tell the audience a little bit about your journey from college to starting Whole Foods?
Maybe the most relevant thing.
Oh, somebody come? Yeah.
Test, test, test. Oh, there we go.
On buttons work.
Yeah. Maybe the most relevant thing, God, I can't see anybody out there. I hear them, though. I was about 19 years old. I was taking this philosophy class, and I was reading this book by Jean-Paul Sartre called Being in Nothingness. And that was a very boring book, I'll tell you. And I remember I threw the book down, and I said, I'm never going to read another book in my life that I don't really want to read. And then that just created this cascading effect, because the next day I thought, you know what, I'm never going to take a class again I don't want to take, which led to me dropping every class.
Okay, students, don't listen to that.
Well, I have 120 hours of electives. and no degree.
The customized degree at its finest.
I got a good education. I just didn't get certified for it, credentialed for it.
Come to the University of Denver.
And then I made this decision that I was never going to actually do anything again that I really didn't want to do. And I made this decision at 19 that I would follow my heart, wherever it led me. I realized that life was very short. Nobody's getting out of here alive. And in view of that, we really ought to go for what we care about, what we're passionate about. So I began this path of only doing what I really wanted to do, the things I really cared about, and stop doing what everybody else wanted me to do. So I became very self-directed. And then that led me, I moved into this vegetarian co-op when I was in my early 20s. Wasn't a vegetarian at the time, but I had my food consciousness awakened there. I learned how to cook, I learned about healthy eating, and I had found my purpose. I'd realized, man, this is what I really care about, this is what I want to do. Went to work for a small natural food store called Good Foods, did that for 6 months and felt like I was now ready to launch my own business. So I came home and to the co-op and asked my girlfriend, which is probably why I moved into the co-op, when you get right down to it.
Always follow the girls at the advice.
Well, I was following my heart.
Okay.
So I said, let's open our own store, and Renee got very excited about it, and which is good because she hadn't been. I don't know if I would have done it. And we went out and raised $45,000 in capital from friends and family. I borrowed my $10,000 from my father, which I did pay back, like Bill Daniels. I didn't pay him any interest, but he did own stock in the company, so he made millions with this stock. So, but anyhow, that's kind of how we got started, and we found this small store. First store was not called Whole Foods, it was called Safer Way. And yes, it was a take on Safeway. We did that for a couple of years, managed to lose half our capital in the first year. We lost 23,000 of the 45,000 we had, even though Renee and I were only making $200 a month and living in the building. But the second year we started to figure it out, and then we relocated, got a much better location, merged with another store, and renamed it Whole Foods Market, and we took off.
It's really a remarkable story, and it's rare that the founder of a company stays through for such a long period of time as CEO. And today we were just talking backstage, 350 stores, $12 billion company. How has your thinking evolved as a business person over the last journey that you've been on?
Well, I don't think we have enough time to talk about how my thinking has evolved over a 34-year period. It's evolved a lot. Because I didn't know anything. I didn't take any business classes. So we learned by making a lot of mistakes. I read hundreds of business books. And fortunately for me, my father was an accounting professor at Rice University for 19 years. And then he went into business and he became a CEO of a public company before he was done. And he acted as my mentor. I actually talk about that in the book some, importance of mentors and coaches. And he helped me a lot. And save me from making many mistakes. But my thinking has evolved. The original higher purpose of Whole Foods was to sell healthy foods to people, have fun, and earn a living. And of course, that higher purpose has evolved over time to much more ambitious in scope. But my thinking about business has gone through many, 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 many evolutionary transitions, and it's gotten more complex. Just as human beings, we can evolve. Companies can evolve. Cultures can evolve. And my thinking has evolved, but I can't really give you all the details from it and be succinct.
That's great. So right now, you've just finished this book on conscious capitalism, and it seems like a summary of where your thinking is today as a business purpose person. Can you give just the audience a few backgrounds on what is conscious capitalism?
Okay, well, we frame the book up around the four key tenets of conscious capitalism. And they all fit together, so you really can't be conscious business unless all four tenets are in play. But the first one is that business has the potential for a higher purpose beyond just making money. Not that there's anything wrong with making money. Money is essential for a business to flourish, and creating value for your investors is an important stakeholder. But just as my body can't exist if it doesn't produce red blood cells. No red blood cells, I'd die. But the purpose of my life is not to produce red blood cells. I have a more transcendent purpose to my life. Well, similarly, business can't exist without profits. Without profits, it can't renew itself. It can't repair buildings and equipment when it wear out. They can't innovate. They can't create the new. They can't respond to competition. So profit's essential to business. But that doesn't mean it's its purpose. Doctors are well compensated in our society, but their purpose isn't to make money. It's to heal people. Teachers educate. Architects design buildings. Engineers construct things. Theoretically, journalists should be unveiling the truth and helping to discover it. Many of our professions are a little bit off these days. Only is business put in this very narrow, rather unflattering box that it's all about money, and that's all that matters. And I've known hundreds of entrepreneurs in my lifetime. Very few of them started their business primarily to make money. They wanted to make money, to be sure, but they were mostly on fire about something. They had some kind of passion, some kind of dream that they wanted to realize in the world, and that's why they created their businesses. So the first tenet is business must discover or rediscover why it exists. What difference is it making in the world? What value is it creating? The second tenet is that you need to create value for all of the stakeholders, not just the investors. We identify the major stakeholders. It can vary depending on the business, but for most businesses, it would be customers, employees, suppliers, investors, communities, and also the environment to do your business and minimize your environmental impact. So these are all, those stakeholders all work together. And a simple way I sometimes explain it to people is that at Whole Foods Market, we hire the very best people we can find. We make sure they're well trained and that they are happy in their workplace, that they flourish. Because we found that when our team members are happy, then they serve our customers better, and that helps our customers to be happy. If our customers are happy, then they tell their friends about the business, they market it, and the business flourishes. And so the investors are happy. Happy team members results in happy customers, results in happy investors. And you also have suppliers that are part of your competitive landscape. We do business in communities. So these stakeholders all fit together, and the conscious business realizes that, and then simultaneously develop strategies where all of the stakeholders can win. Business is not a win-lose game. It's a win-win-win-win game. And that's what makes it so beautiful and so powerful in how it's transformed our lives. The third tenet is we need a different type of leadership. Not a leadership that's in there to line its own pockets and extract as much money as possible out of the business and get all the perks of being in the corporation, their own jets and all these special privileges for being they're not kings. They're not noble princes. They should be servants to the organization. So I'm a great believer in servant leadership. And conscious leaders tend to have higher emotional intelligence, higher spiritual intelligence, and they tend to be servant leaders. The fourth tenet is you have to create cultures that are empowered and allow human beings to flourish, that allow human beings to self-actualize themselves and reach their highest potential. So the four tenets of conscious capitalism: higher purpose, stakeholder integration, conscious leadership, and empowered cultures.
So let's go back for a minute, and because you mentioned a few things that were bad about business. Why do you think business today is getting such a bad rap?
Well, you have to understand business has always been hated. This is not a new thing. Business has been hated for thousands of years. The intellectuals have always hated business, and they hate it today. Aristocrats, the elites of society have always hated business. Think about it. The business people have oftentimes been minorities in societies. For example, in the Western society, oftentimes Jews were the business people, the money lenders. And they've been persecuted in country after country, run out of countries, really climaxing, of course, with the Holocaust in not too long ago. In the East, the Chinese have been equally persecuted in country after country where they would do commerce and rise up. And I think you can get into lots of reasons why business has been persecuted. My favorite theory is that the intellectuals and the aristocrats hate business people primarily out of envy. The business people make more money than they do, and they evaluate it and say, I don't know why that guy, I'm a lot smarter than he is. He's not that smart. Why should he have more money than me? And that seems unfair. It seems unjust. And so business has always been put in this box of being selfish and greedy and exploitative. And the critics of business are the ones that dominate the narrative. Part of the reason we've written this book is to try to change that narrative, to portray business in a different light. Secondarily, business is sometimes its own worst enemy. There are bad practitioners in business. I would say business is usually judged by its worst practitioners, the Enrons and the WorldComs and the Bernie Madoffs and Wall Street banks taint all of business's reputation. The bad actors are the ones that get written up in the newspapers, and people generalize that to see it as the whole society, which is not, it's odd because it's not done by other areas in our society. We don't put in the newspapers about bad doctors who took the wrong kidney out, or a journalist who plagiarizes, or buildings that fall down. The engineers are not called out there. So business is almost in its own way singled out and castigated for the bad actors, and there are bad actors everywhere. It's interesting, Gallup shows that business's reputation in our society has only got a 19% approval rate. That means 81% of the population no longer approves of business. That's a real problem. And if business is going to be able to maintain its autonomy in our society, that reputation is going to have to change. I find it very interesting that the Economic Freedom Index, for a long time the United States was number one in the world. By the year 2000, we'd slipped to number 3 behind Hong Kong and Singapore. In 2012, we'd fallen to number 18. Economic freedom is declining in America, and with that decline, so is our prosperity.
So you talked about the people who are bringing a bad rap to business, but let's talk a little bit about the heroic spirit. Certainly, Bill Daniels was somebody that embodied that, and he left quite a legacy even after he passed away. Who do you consider to be leaders that have the heroic spirit, and also companies that embody some of the tenets that you describe?
Well, some of the examples we write about in the book are people like Southwest Airlines. Herb Kelleher is one of the original conscious capitalists in my mind, an amazing guy, created a great company. More current companies that are relatively new, companies like Google is an absolutely incredible company. The Container Store, I think, is a great example. Nordstrom's, Panera Bread. A lot of the 100 best companies to work for fall in that category. I think Amazon.com has elements of that. Bright Horizons Healthcare. And mind you, consciousness is always on a continuum. There are no perfect companies out there. So critics love to come up and point out Whole Foods Market's flaws or failures if they're saying anything meaningful. Because, of course, Whole Foods isn't perfect. We're improving, we're evolving, we're moving up in consciousness, but we're not perfect. We still make mistakes, and we're still learning. I made some mistakes in the last couple of weeks. I've learned some valuable lessons.
I'll ask you about that in a minute.
Well, no need to, because I've learned my lessons there. So.
Well, we want to learn from you as well. So let's kind of stay on that for a minute. So certainly the tenets of conscious capitalism are clear, but you and I both know it's very difficult to implement them in companies today. So what kind of advice do you give to people who want to start moving towards conscious capitalism, and what are some of the good things to do, and what are some things to perhaps avoid?
You know, it's not that difficult for a new business to be this way. They have no legacy to overcome. The entrepreneurs can create a conscious business from the very beginning. In fact, in a lot of ways, we wrote this book for the millennial generation, because the millennials are the ones that are going to create the conscious businesses that will transform the world in the 21st century. My generation is, to a certain extent, ideologically locked in now. I'm not saying it's incapable of learning, but it's rigidified to a certain extent. Whereas I find young people refreshingly open-minded and eager to embrace new paradigms. So this book's really geared towards young entrepreneurs who want to start conscious businesses up from scratch. We want to show them how to do it, and we want to give them permission to do it, because sometimes they're afraid to do it because afraid that maybe they're going to mess up their business. But what we've discovered is that conscious businesses outperform economically in almost every metric. It was a kind of a staggering information. If you go to Appendix A, we try to document that. For more established businesses, it's more difficult. They have legacy to overcome. They have inertia. If that's the old, if it ain't broke, don't fix it mentality. So sometimes you can't fix something until it's broken, which is a shame, because maybe you don't need to get broken if you would able to evolve yourself before you get into desperate times. The first thing a legacy business needs to do is it needs to rediscover its purpose. Why does it exist? Usually the entrepreneur that created the company had a higher purpose, even if they hadn't articulated it. It may have been tacit, maybe not made explicit. So they need to go on a purpose search. They need to bring their stakeholder group together, and together they need to come up with, discover, or create their deeper purpose beyond just making money. Then they need to start thinking about how can we consciously create value for our stakeholders, and how can we evolve our leadership to be in sync with this, and how do we consciously create cultures that allow human beings to flourish and be empowered. So it's possible to do it, but it will require the CEO in particular to buy into it, because otherwise the CEO will sabotage it.
We had Kent Theory, the CEO of DaVita, here, and he talked a lot about how it took a lot of faith from his board to move to a concept called the village, which is very much mm-hmm. a lot of what you talk about here in conscious capitalism, where they do have a higher purpose and they create a community within their own organization so they can better serve kidney patients. He did talk a lot about creating culture within his company, mm-hmm. and so I want to spend a few minutes talking about the Whole Foods culture. But before we do that, I think we've got a video we're going to queue up just to give a little flavor to the audience for what Whole Foods is like.
Okay.
Virtually all progress in the world is ultimately dependent on communication. Communication is the essence of what it means to be human. When you unleash creativity and you permit communication, unexpected things happen.
The energy around our place of work is one of purpose. To create stories around the work that we do as a company, food is an incredible story, and it's connected to everyone.
What started out as seeming to be something that would impact a small number of people has really burgeoned, has grown a great deal. What we do at Whole Foods is set a standard. We don't do it with the idea of necessarily making the world a better place. I think that kind of grows from it.
You can ask where your food comes from. You can ask how it's grown. You can ask who is responsible for it. We all enjoy this story. And now we're going to share that story with a lot more people. And we're going to create more opportunities for them to contribute their own stories.
I communicate to our customers every day in literally thousands of little ways.
There are new ways of communicating.
You're reaching customers directly and they're reaching back to us directly.
Whatever your role is at this company, you have a voice. You have that moment where you're communicating with the customer.
All of us choose to work here for a reason that goes beyond having a job. I think the greatest thing that we could do is share that purpose with the customer.
Human flourishing is a beautiful thing. And this is going to encourage that flourishing, and that's beautiful.
This is our chance to say something.
Use your voice.
This is our chance.
This is your chance.
To say something.
This is our chance to be heard.
Use your voice.
Say something. Speak.
So how do you describe the culture at Whole Foods?
I've never seen that video before. It's really pretty cool.
Is that your
sums
company?
Up the Whole Foods culture. It's very decentralized, very empowered. It's not really a top-down authoritarian command and control structure. It's unleashed the creativity of individuals. My vision's always been that people can align with the higher purpose of the business, and you can unleash their creative energy, but it's aligned through the purpose, you are far more innovative, creative company. So the unique things about Whole Foods culture, we're highly decentralized. We're not an authoritarian top-down organization. We're divided into 12 regions. Each of the regions is into stores. The stores are organized into teams. The teams are empowered. The stores are empowered. The regions are empowered to create value for our customers and to fulfill our purpose, to fulfill our mission. So you decentralize, then you empower. Decentralization plus empowerment leads to innovation. Innovation in this society that we live in now that's connected together through the internet, you put collaboration into the mix, and you have continuous innovation and continuous improvement because ideas spread. Collaboration improves on them, and the organization continues to evolve upwards. Imagine if you can unleash the creative energy. We have 73,000 people working for our company. If you can unleash all that creative energy and allow it to manifest in the world, you'll have this dynamic organization that's very difficult to compete with in the marketplace. And that's kind of our culture and our vision.
So culture is easier when you start one store, but it's definitely much more difficult when you have 73,000 employees and over 350 stores. How much of your time is spent thinking and actively engaging with the culture of the organization?
Quite a bit. I mean, I really feel like in the conscious business, you can't take your culture for granted. Most people kind of take their culture for granted, and that's a huge mistake. Now, I think about the culture all the time. I try to identify things that I think are dysfunctional in the culture or maybe working cross purposes with why the organization exists. And to then, like a good doctor, to go in and diagnose it and begin to try to root it out. So I think that you cannot assume your culture will stay healthy. It's more like a garden that has weeds in it that pop up. You've got to weed it, and you've got to stay vigilant. So I don't know what percentage of my time I think about the business all the time, and I think about the culture, and I try to lead by example. I try to, through my talks, I try to guide, I try to lead. Hey, I just wrote a book.
In
a sense, this is the biggest contribution I've made to the Whole Foods culture because the team members are going to read it, and they're going to hopefully be inspired about it. And where the vision I put forth there is not being upheld at Whole Foods, they can say, well, John Mackey says we ought to be doing it this way, and we're not. And they'll create a little revolution.
So before they throw you out of office, let's talk about leadership as CEO. You know, we've got a lot of students in the audience, and they're probably thinking, conscious leader, what does that mean exactly? What does that mean I should be doing on a day-to-day basis? What does that mean I should be doing on a short-term basis, a long-term basis? What do you think they should be concerned with if they're going to be our next generation of business leaders? How do they become a conscious leader?
Well, you have to evolve. You have to evolve your awareness. We identify four major types of intelligence as in the book that are relevant to business. The first one is analytical intelligence or cognitive intelligence, intelligence that our IQ tests measure, the intelligence, frankly, that you're rewarded for in school, the ability to analyze things and compare and contrast, a very valuable type of intelligence. But increasingly in the 21st century, we need other types of intelligences to be a conscious leader. Emotional intelligence is something, of course, that's become popularized in the last 15 years or so, Daniel Goleman. And honestly, I have found that emotional intelligence is a better predictor of success at Whole Foods than analytical intelligence. At Whole Foods, I like to tell the story that, how many people here read Steve Jobs' biography that came out in the last, quite a few, not as many as I might have thought, but when I read that book, of course, Steve Jobs, the greatest entrepreneur of my generation, a brilliant man, and Apple's the most valuable company in the entire world. And they've transformed a number of industries from music to computers to retail. But if Steve Jobs had gone to work for Whole Foods Market, he would not have been voted in by his team. Because as brilliant as he was and as creative as he was, he did not have a high degree of emotional intelligence from my perspective after reading the book. At Whole Foods Market, that's really a premium because we're so team-oriented and your ability to communicate and connect with other people in a constructive way is very important. I think you need spiritual intelligence to be a conscious leader. By spiritual intelligence, I mean the ability to see purpose, to understand values, to have a strong ethical consciousness. I used to think that was something that came natural to people, but as I've gotten older, I realize, my God, so many people are just blind to this. They can't see purpose. They don't see values. They aren't primarily ethical. They believe in their own self-interest all the time. And you really can't build a society strictly on the basis of self-interest. It won't work. It'll break down. So you need spiritual intelligence. And finally, I think you need systems intelligence. The ability to see how it all fits together, to see the relationships. Whenever I talk about stakeholders, I inevitably get somebody with high analytical intelligence to be saying, well, that all sounds very fine, Mr. Mackey. But what about the trade-offs? How do you balance these stakeholders? As if their analytical intelligence begins to see conflict. They begin to see that the higher their analytical intelligence is, generally, they've done well on IQ tests, and they may be business professors and whatnot in school, but they may not have a well-developed systems intelligence, so they can't see the relationships, and they only see conflicts, they only see trade-offs. And the systems mind can see how it fits together and can begin to develop strategies where there aren't any trade-offs, where there's just win, 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 win. And that's the art of conscious leadership, is to create the win, win, win strategies. And when you come up with trade-offs, you've just had a failure of systems intelligence. You have not been able to see the relationship. You have not been creative enough to come up with new, innovative solutions to problems. So, to be a conscious leader, you need to develop your emotional intelligence, your spiritual intelligence, your systems intelligence, and you need to be a servant leader. You need to really care about the mission of the organization and identify with it and help to further it. It's not about lining your own pockets. It's not about your ego getting on top. When leaders that are like that will frankly sub-optimize their business in the long term, and they'll, even if it's a conscious business, if you get the wrong leader there, that business will begin to contract.
Now, one of the things you also talked about in the beginning of your book was the powerful network that you had that helped you out of a pretty dire situation back in Austin. Would you describe that network and what happened to the audience?
Yeah, in the introduction of the book, I talk about this, and part of the book is describing my own awakenings as a leader, so I could personalize it. And my one of my early awakenings was we had moved Safeway, merged with another store, and created Whole Foods Market. And the store was fabulously successful from the first day. It became the highest volume natural food store in the United States and probably the world within just a few months. And then Austin experienced the worst flood it experienced in over 100 years. And our store was 8 feet underwater. We were bankrupt. And it was like a nightmare. I was down there that night after the flood, and literally, Renee, the co-founder, my girlfriend, she swam out of the store. And the store was completely wrecked. We came in the next day. We didn't have flood insurance. And we knew we were broke. I mean, all our inventory was destroyed. All our equipment was destroyed. But what happened the next day really changed our destiny, and it changed my thinking about business forever. Because we had dozens of customers show up the next day and help us clean up the store. And a company that should have died was saved by its stakeholders. Our team members worked for free. Our customers helped us clean up the store. Our bank loaned us more money on my signature, no collateral. And I promise you, my signature, I was thinking about changing my name. That's how bad my signature was back then. The investors put more capital in. Our suppliers gave us new inventory on credit, even though they knew we couldn't pay them with any initial, we didn't have no cash behind it. And somehow, miraculously, our business got reopened 30 days later. And that's when I realized that stakeholders matter, that they are the lifeblood of a company. And I just never forgot that lesson. I realized I've got to pay all these people back. They loved us. They didn't let us die. And I realized I love the stakeholders too, and I still do.
So, you know, one of the messages that comes out pretty clearly around leadership is that you do have to create a powerful network, invest in your stakeholders. And we've had some conversations with a couple of our alums who've shown the counter side to that. So Sean Mackey was the former CEO of Frontier Airlines, and he articulated a story much like you after 9/11, the power of the stakeholders and the network that they had with the company and people pitching in really to overcome this devastating, you know, effect that occurred. And then we also had Jim Luntz, who's the CEO of Toyota North America, talk about the tsunami that occurred in Japan. But what both of them then gave were examples of the fragility of their networks. In Toyota's case, they didn't realize how devastating the tsunami was down their supply chain, mm-hmm. that it wasn't just the first and second layer, it was the third, fourth, and fifth. And they hadn't prepared adequately to see that kind of devastation go through their entire supply chain. In the case of Frontier, in 2008, they needed to refinance. And everybody was going through economic crisis at that time, so their network wasn't available to help them out. So they both said that one of the lessons they really learned was that while they felt they had really strong relationships with their stakeholders and they had powerful networks, that they were very fragile. Have you had any cases like that with Whole Foods or anything that you worry about in terms of your stakeholders or your network?
Well, I think in both those cases, well, see, Frontier, like many airlines, was probably over-leveraged. Mm-hmm. That's just a business mistake. You're very vulnerable to any kind of a downturn. That's when businesses go bankrupt if they have too much debt. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, that's true not just at Frontier, but through most of the airline industry. An integrated manufacturer like Toyota is so dependent on its supply chain of suppliers that I can see why disruption there could be harmful. The answer to that, of course, is to have redundancy built into the supply chain so you don't have all of your supply chain eggs in one basket. I'm sure now both companies have learned their lessons.
Yes, absolutely.
And they've probably retooled, you might mm-hmm. say. In Whole Foods' case, where are we most vulnerable, which is kind of what you're asking in terms of stakeholders? Well, we're not vulnerable on the financial side. We don't have any debt. Great team member base. I suppose where Whole Foods is most vulnerable, God, I mean, I hate to articulate this to the people that hate me out there, but I suppose if we were to have some kind of major food deaths, I mean, where hundreds of people died from poisoning of some kind, I think that would obviously be bad for the people that died and be really bad for our company.
Yeah, definitely worse for the people that died probably than your company, but...
Well, that's a lose-lose.
Yes, absolutely. You know, it was a pretty powerful message from these executives because I think they had been moving in a model much like yours where they had so many of their stakeholders take care of them and they hadn't thought through all the different scenarios, so it's definitely something for our students to be thinking about. So let me just talk a little bit about leaders in the public eye. Certainly, you can't pick up the newspaper without a CEO having a headline, and you've made the headline quite a few times in the last few weeks. I don't want to talk about the specific instances, but I do want to have a conversation on what is the role of a CEO in stating his or her public opinions and perhaps denigrating the value of the company or having a negative effect on a company because of his or her opinions?
It's a difficult question. What tends to happen is if a CEO speaks up and it's not in sync with the overall values of the media, and it's going to be denigrated, and it creates a chilling effect, and the CEO is put under a lot of pressure, which I think is a shame, because I think to have a vital democracy, we've got to have freedom of speech, and business sector should not be cowed and intimidated into silence while it watches economic freedom decline in America, while it watches our country begin to decline. And if the business sector is too scared and cowed to speak up, then ultimately when their businesses when they come for their business, there'll be no one to blame but themselves. So, that being said, you also have responsibility to your organization. So you take a risk, because of course what happens when you do speak up, that the attacks are not directly, there are a lot of attacks at you, and then a lot of attacks are made at your company. And a lot of attacks go to your board, demanding that they fire this guy, or they muzzle him, or they replace him, or they, you know, put him on a leash. And he's saying things that are threatening to the larger viewpoints that are being articulated by the elites. So business has a right to participate in a democratic society, and it shouldn't be intimidated, it shouldn't be cowed into silence. And I'm worried about our future in America, and I feel some societal responsibility to be authentic and honest. I don't go out of my way to be controversial. I really am just an honest human being who says it like I see it, and oftentimes I'm amazed that people get so upset. and I always feel like I'm getting misinterpreted too, and I feel like I'm getting smeared and slandered. So I tell you, it's not much fun.
Yeah, it's definitely tough, tough. But the authenticity, I think, is an important piece of it for CEOs to continue to remember and to continue to have the voice. Well, I've taken up enough of your time. How about if we open it up for questions from the audience?
Sounds good.
Okay.
I don't think they're going to ask me any tougher ones than you have.
So here we go, first question.
Oh, there are people out there. Okay, no further questions? That's great.
That was easy.
Yeah. No.
We can hear you. How about if you state the question and we'll repeat it?
Whole Foods. I originally visited your store down in Houston back in 82, and I was excited about the concept of a new natural food store because I'm very much a foodie. I'm very much into Whole Foods, natural foods, that is. And I do spread the wealth between Vitamin Cottage and Whole Foods. However, my main concern is the genetically modified foods that you do carry, and in particular, a lot of your prepared foods use canola oil, which, as you know, is 95% genetically modified. And I've asked store managers about this, and they said it's a matter of cost. But now your grape leaves contain canola oil, as does all your hot food. And so that's a concern, because I'm very much organic-based, and soy lecithin is another concern.
Yeah. But what's your question?
My question is, to be considered free of GMOs, you have to submit to the non-GMO project, which I'm sure you're aware of, and I just wondered what your plans are with that, and if you are going to be incorporating more organic produce, for example.
Well, Whole Foods is, first of all, I mean, every supermarket in the United States sells foods with GMOs in it, so we sell less than any other supermarket in the United States, as a matter of fact, but there's been a campaign, again, to smear Whole Foods Market as if we're in partnership with Monsanto in some way, and a lot of lies are told about us, and so it's difficult. What we're going to do is, Whole Foods is going to work towards complete transparency in our stores. We already have that with our private label. We know that's all been submitted to the to make sure they're non-GMO verified, and we're going to gradually work through our entire supply chain so that. And we will label foods that we are certain have GMOs in it after they've been tested. So that's what we're going to work for. We're going to work towards total transparency so the customers will understand. We'll be the only food store in America doing that. There are lots of food stores that might claim they don't sell GMOs, but they're simply dishonest. And some of our competitors claim that, but it's demonstrably not true. So we're going to work towards transparency in our supply chain. Hopefully that'll set a good example for everybody else.
Next. We're going to go up to Parterre.
Well, When we had the economic collapse, the thing that concerned me about corporate America is the lack of taking responsibilities for one's actions. If you looked at the Fortune 500 today, how many of those CEOs do you think would be willing to take responsibility for what they have done?
26 and a half. I don't know how to answer that question because obviously I don't know. I do think business was blamed largely for that financial collapse. When I personally see it very differently. I see it as bad regulatory oversights. We already had a financial sector that was highly regulated. I saw lots of subprime loans being made, which banks were being forced to do, which no sober, responsible banker would have made if the government wasn't pressuring them to do it. I see the wrong incentive programs being set up by bad regulations. Also see a Fed that was making easy credit available, gunning the money supply, creating asset bubbles in real estate. And I see a bunch of greedy Wall Street bankers that were gambling on it at 40 to 50 to 101 debt to equity ratios. I see blame in a lot of different places. Most of the Fortune 500 had nothing to do with it. I mean, certainly my company didn't. You can blame some financial institutions if you wish, and you can blame the government. I think most of the Fortune 500 is not in that sector and I have to say they're guiltless. I certainly don't think my company had anything to do with it. We're in the Fortune 500.
Next question from okay.
Is it on?
There we go.
Yes.
I was just curious, so when you meet with your direct reports, what are the top 4 or 5 business objectives you have today?
Our executive team is 7 individuals, and we function completely as a team. Everybody makes the same amount of money, has the same bonus, same benefits, and we make decisions by consensus. And the truth of the matter is that one of my skills as an executive is I'm pretty good at, I know, I'm very self-aware, so I know what I'm good at, and I know what I'm not good at. And one of the things I'm not good at, I'm a bad manager. I really am. I don't manage people well. So my joke is, if I have to manage you, you cannot report to me. I don't want to have to give you a 5-point plan that you need to do. Other people are good at that, so you need to report to them. I only need people that are so self-motivated and are so on fire and so creative that I just need to unleash that creativity and not manage them. So I'm a great believer in nudging things. I go around and nudge things. Nudge it in this direction, nudge it in that direction. Or I sometimes think of myself as a little honeybee going around dropping pollen in all the beautiful Whole Foods flowers so that they will grow into beautiful, reproduce in beautiful ways. So there would be other people at Whole Foods that could better answer that question because I think organizations, what I really believe that senior leadership of a big corporation requires a diversity and talent. And one of the biggest mistakes a lot of executives make is they promote people that are just like themselves. They identify, oh, this guy reminds me of myself when I was younger and I'm gonna bring him along. I think you should do just the opposite. You should promote people who complement your own weaknesses. I have some very formidable strengths, but I also have a number of weaknesses. And I have surrounded myself with people who cover up for my weaknesses and allow my strengths to shine forth. So you have to create a team, and the team has to be integrated and complement each other well. So that's how I think about it.
Next one right here.
Hi, thank you for coming. My question is, what advice would you give to young entrepreneurs graduating from the Daniels College of Business, and what would you, in your opinion, say are the key steps that they should take to succeed after DU?
Get started. You know, I speak at a lot of business schools around the United States, and one of my favorite questions to ask the students is, how many of you plan on starting a business someday? 2/3 of the typical class raises their hand. And I say, how many of you are going to start a business right after you get your MBA? Almost everybody lowers their hand. Because their dream is someday they're going to create a business, but right now they got a lot of debt. And Wall Street and consulting companies are offering these huge six-figure starting contracts. And they're going to go out and do that for a while and pay off their debts. Of course, they go out there, they do that, they ratchet up their lifestyle, get married, have children, buy an expensive house, and they're going to still start a business someday, but it just someday is someday in the future. The truth about entrepreneurs are on fire. They're on fire for something. They want to go out and do something. Fire ready, aim. They go out and do it. I mean, that's the bottom line. So if that's my advice to you. If you're going to go out and start a business, do it now. And I will tell you one interesting story about this. I once spoke in this Japanese business school, and I asked the same question, and no one raised their hand. I thought it was fascinating. Not one of them wanted to start their own business. Found out later that that's kind of not thought to be, that's very risky behavior to start a business. Chances are you're going to fail. A lot of entrepreneurs fail. I almost failed in the first year, and then almost failed in the third year. So I will tell you, though, that building a business is so much fun. It is unbelievably fun. Life is such an adventure. You will learn so much. You'll meet such interesting people. And I've loved it. It's definitely, I made the right life choice for myself. And I think most people that start businesses have an interesting life. That I can almost assure you. So if you want to do that, go for it. Life is an adventure.
Okay, the next one from up here.
Could you elaborate on and maybe provide some examples of the economic freedoms that you feel we have lost in America and what the remedies might be?
Well, almost every... these got cut out of my book by the editor. But I had listed 10, and I will not be able to recount from memory all 10 of the things that represent economic freedom, but I can name several of them probably. Freedom to innovate, freedom to fail, freedom to trade, a good rule of law that's fair and just across the whole society, property rights, so property rights are respected, not abrogated. Minimal regulations or appropriate regulations and not too many regulations, reasonable taxes. Anyway, those are several of the most important ones. And ask yourself, which of those have increased in economic freedom in the last 10 years and which have declined? I think you'll see that in every case, there's less economic freedom today than there was.
This actually builds a bit on that question. Government by nature has a paternalistic role in society, whether we're talking about farm bills or genetically modified foods, economic stimulus. What do you think the role of government should be in fostering or incentivizing conscious capitalism?
Just get out of the way. I mean, I think government has a very important role to play in society. I'm not an anarchist. I believe in the rule of law. I believe in good government. But you have to understand, government now spends 40% of the GDP of our nation, 40%. And they borrow a big chunk of that, or they just write or just print money. So we created a big government because we were scared of corporations. Somebody had to stop these sociopaths from wrecking everything. So we created a big government. We haven't asked the question, what restrains government? Who governs the government? Who restricts the government? And it's a big question. Our society's got to debate this because government is continuing to grow at a rapid rate. An interesting thing to ponder, you can go check this on the internet if you don't believe me, Google it. People ask, what do we do about this deficit? We've got a $1 trillion deficit. every year. What can we do about that? Do you realize that we could completely eliminate the annual deficit, not the accumulated deficit. We could eliminate the annual deficit in just 10 years and still grow government at 2% a year. You could break every program, Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, Defense, Department of Education, everything, all the discretionary income, and you could increase it at 2% a year. And in 10 years, there wouldn't be an annual deficit. Our problems are the government is growing a lot faster than 2%. If you go back and see how much government has grown in the last 13 years, it's growing at double-digit increases every year. It's growing far faster than the economy. It's completely out of control. So if we're not going to go bankrupt, somehow or another, government will have to find a way to restrain itself. And that is the big question, in my opinion, for our society right now. How do we limit government? We used to have a constitution that did it, but it's not effective any longer. And so our nation's moving towards rapidly some type of crisis point. I don't know what's going to happen. I always joke, if you just predict 10 years off, then nobody will remember you made that prediction. So sometime in the next 10 years, we're going to have some type of major crisis.
We'll remember.
Yeah, but I'll probably be retired by then, so I'll be okay.
Hi, you made some headlines last year by slashing prices on some of your staple goods, I think by as much as 50%, which I thought was an interesting marketing exercise. Can you maybe talk about how that played out at the leadership level and how your financial stakeholders took the news and if there was any pushback either within the organization or in your stakeholder network?
I don't know if we slashed prices 50%. That's news to me. I may be in the marketing department there. But Whole Foods Market has worked diligently to lower our prices, and we've been very successful at it. Despite the way it's portrayed in the media, we know from our own price surveys, and if anybody goes and digs deeper, that we've got a huge number of really well-priced value prices. We match Trader Joe's prices. They're coming here into Colorado. We match their prices with our private label line. But we're a quality food company. Just like any other area of our society, whether it be housing or clothing or automobiles, there are a whole spectrum of price to quality ratios. And we've decided to sell the highest quality food we can find. We want it to be as good a price as we can muster, but most importantly, we want to have it be the highest quality. And there is a trade-off, in a sense, between the lowest prices and the highest quality. And we all make those choices in our own lives, and Whole Foods Market's strategy is to be the high-quality provider and to be as price competitive as we can within that overall strategy of having the highest quality. So we've fought the good fight on keeping our prices as competitive as possible. We're making good progress, and I still got a long way to go, I think.
Okay, one right over here.
Yes, yes. When it comes to too much versus the right amount of government, I think the problem in society runs much deeper. And let's look at the Deep Horizon explosion in the Gulf of Mexico. For decades, those states successfully kept OSHA and the EPA at bay so the oil industry could operate as they desired down there. When the well exploded, the first response out of the civilian population down there is, where's the government? Where's my check? Where's the cleanup? What's the government doing? It's this, you know, and these gun shootings in schools, it's always the first response of society to ask, what is the government doing about it?
You're working
towards
the question.
They ask government to grow. So where do you draw the balance between limiting government and responsible government versus the general population always asking the government to solve a problem for them?
This is the debate, the discussion we have to have in our society. There is no magical formula I can point to. All I can say is now the government's spending 40% of the GDP and it's growing at a double-digit clip. So it's not sustainable. It will not continue to do that. It will change one way or another. Something will change. We'll go bankrupt or we'll get our government expenses under control. Of course we need intelligent regulations, particularly we need those in the environment. We are going to have to figure this out. This is, I'll put the challenge to the young people here. And I'll tell you a story. When I was young, this world was really screwed up. And I couldn't believe my parents could screw it up so much. It's like, couldn't you guys have done a better job? And then when I got older, I realized, gosh, that my parents, when they were, was all screwed up when they got here too. So each generation solves the problems it can solve, and it really leaves the challenge to the younger generation. You've got to solve problems we couldn't figure out. So I'm pretty sure I know the problem, but that doesn't necessarily mean I know the solutions. And you know, I've been doing my part for a long time now. I think Whole Foods has made a major contribution to improving the welfare of a lot of people. We've helped millions of people live better, healthier lives. And the challenges that we have, I don't necessarily know the solutions for them, but I know, I have great faith in the creativity of people. I believe in entrepreneurs, both business entrepreneurs and social entrepreneurs, to come up with creative solutions to most of our problems. And that's what we need to do, is unleash that creative entrepreneurial energy. And I put that challenge out to the young people here. I didn't create this messed up world, and I've worked really hard to do what I can to make it better. And I challenge you to do the same thing. Take responsibility for it. Go out and create the businesses, the conscious businesses, that will help make our world a better place. And if you're unwilling to do that, then we can expect more and more government and more bureaucracy and shrinking prosperity, high unemployment, massive debts, and a great country continuing to decline.
Great. I think we have just one last question from the parterre.
Could you please share with us some ideas as to how to increase our system's intelligence as well as the spiritual intelligence, A, and B, how can we as a society do the same for corporations so that then we can tell government to get out of the way? Because the way it is right now is kind of hard, knowing that many of them have profit as their number one objective.
I didn't understand that whole question.
So I believe I'm going to rephrase the question. How do you actually develop emotional and spiritual intelligence? And then how do you get companies to focus on the conscious capitalism versus just focusing only on profit?
That's why I wrote a book. That's what's in the book. You should be one of the people that buys the book, because those are the things I talk about. No, I'm... In the book, we talk about how to develop emotional intelligence, how to develop spiritual intelligence, how to develop systems intelligence. We talk about, the whole book is written so business can begin to discover higher purpose and move away from simply a profit-centric model. That's the purpose of the book. That's why we wrote it. And I do think there are ways to develop those intelligences, and I do think businesses can discover their higher purpose, because lots of businesses are. And if something's possible, then that proves it's possible. So I really can't recap, completely encapsulate, you know, 368 pages in a few simple sentences. I did the best I could to frame it up with purpose, stakeholders, leadership, and culture. But now that was to tease you into going to buy the book, and then hopefully you'll find value there, and it'll stimulate your thinking, and then come back and talk to me.
John Mackey, everyone.
Thank you.
I think you'll agree that we could spend hours having a conversation with him about everything that he's learned and everything he knows. John is graciously going to be out in our lobby signing books, so if you would like to join us in the lobby for a reception and to meet John up close and personal, please do so. Thank you so much.
Don't go. Could you give a round of applause for Christine, who I think did an amazing job tonight? Thank you.
Thank you so much for being a part of the Daniels College of Business community. Next month, join us again for Maxine Clark, CEO of Build-A-Bear. Thank you again.